It's a matter of utmost pleasure for us and for the entire team of Hindu College Gazette and the Symposium Society to host Dr. Ganesh Devi with us for this conversation. So, today we are having Padma Shri Dr. Ganesh Devi, so IRN on behalf of Hindu College Gazette and the entire team of the Symposium Society, offer my warmest welcomes and greetings to Dr. Devi. Although you all must be familiar with the great works of Dr. Devi and his activism also, but the prestigious contributions of Dr. Devi to the society is not just in the field of linguistics, it also expands its domain to the fields of social equality, his works for the tribal justice and all. Okay, he is the man behind the People's Linguistic Survey of India, which is the largest ever survey of languages in history. The survey was carried out by 3,000 volunteers and was published in over 50 multilingual volumes. Sir also was a professor of English, and me being a student of English, it's like a special attraction to you, sir, that you are a professor of English for about 15 years. Among dozens of international and national awards that Dr. Devi has been facilitated with include the prestigious Sahitya Academy Award, which sir also returned as to mark his protest against the attacks on the Indian intellectuals. Sir has also been awarded with the Sarth Writers Foundation Award in 2001, Prince Claus Award in 2003, and the prestigious Padma Shri in 2014, in recognition for his work with denotified and nomadic tribes and endangered languages. Sir, in Hindi, there's a saying, ek kahawat hai ki, for about India, that kos kos par pani badle, char kos par vani. About India, we say that kos kos par pani badle, char kos par vani. So in such a nation, where diversity forms a basic instinct of its, we can say, international recognition, basic instinct of its, glorified history, a basic instinct of its contemporary society. So in such a language, since you literally have worked a lot in this field, so in such a nation, seeing that the languages and the cultures dying, okay, they literally are dying. You also, I read your survey, sir, you mentioned that about 50 languages die per year in India. Okay, so in such a nation, like how is it to see these languages dying? So first of all, I literally like want to have an introduction with you for 2 or 3 minutes about the work, about the PLSI, and the basic background of what actually is the cause that is leading to all this happening.
You see, thank you for your question. In the human history, there has been a trend that wherever there is enough water and the soil is fertile, people who came out of Africa thousands of years ago settled and survived without having to move ahead in their migration. Now, for any language to be a language, to remain alive, to allow that language to grow in all its domains, a certain minimum number of speakers or listeners are necessary. Not just two, but a few hundred, several hundred. Now, in this process of migration, because people did not have to necessarily move ahead, many of them settled at one place and developed large families. I'm going back to a time that's roughly 40,000 years before our time. So these large families are called in linguistics, in history of languages, a population knot, K-N-O-T. And they become the basis of a new language. Now, in our country, what we call country, but in South Asia, because of the availability of large rivers and fertile soil and plenty of animals to hunt at one time, these many languages started growing side by side by side. And that is how, as you described, Kos Kos Pe Pani Badle, Kos Kos Pe Vani happened in this country. We became a nation, we became a subcontinent of great language diversity. There are three most important diversity, language diversity spots in the world. In Asia or Asia Australia, one is India, another is Indonesia, and the third is Papua New Guinea. There's maximum number of languages in Papua New Guinea, followed by Indonesia and followed by India. Now the sequence has changed. It is Papua New Guinea, India, and then Indonesia. This is the historical context. Now, I move to the 21st century after Christ, that is our present time. At the beginning of this millennium, beginning of this century, we did not have a clear idea about the number of languages spoken in the country and number of languages that are alive. There was a survey carried out by a very dedicated Britishman, Irishman, called George Grierson, 100 years before our time. But that survey was old. The map of India was different. And Grierson had not been able to cover all of it. So it was there, but it was not complete. Similarly, there was the Census of India giving a list of languages claimed by people as their mother tongues. But the census data, as disclosed to people, was very often truncated data, compressed data, inadequate data. So when I was your age, when I was a student, if somebody had asked me the question, how many languages does India have? There was no easy answer. I would have said at that time, yes, there is a certain number of languages included in the 8th schedule, but there are others. Yes, there are languages for which the Sahitya Academy gives literary awards, but there are more. So there was no fixed count of languages. And because there was no fixed count of languages in the country, developmental activities, development-related activities in our country were not brought together with the linguistic reality. So very often, people were given such development projects which would induce migration out of their own language zone. Supposing some people who speak Asuri language and are forced to migrate to Delhi, there they become quite helpless. Their children suffer in schools. They feel alienated in their society. And all of this happening with one language can happen with hundreds of other languages. I found in the PLSI, the People's Linguistic Survey exercise, presence of over 700 languages. So if it happens to those 700 languages or most of them, then the cumulative effect on the society would be enormous. It is a disturbing effect. It involves a great human tragedy because people's mother tongues are denied, Matrubhasha is denied. People's developmental opportunities are minimized in order to overcome these difficulties. I decided to start that language survey. And it happened. That survey is now published in book form. So many volumes are already available in libraries and to the members of public. Yeah, I have answered your question.
Yes, sir. Sir, as you said, like I was reading some of your statements, so I found a very interesting statement of yours that literally linked this linguistic diversity to the contemporary society by saying that in order to protect our democracy, we need to keep our languages alive. Okay, so sir, then how exactly can we like relate the languages to our democracy on a national forum?
See, when the idea of democracy started developing in Europe, it took two very distinct paths. One was a democracy wedded to the idea of nation, as in Italy and Germany. There was a second kind of democracy, idea of democracy, which was wedded to the idea of freedom, as in Ireland, or in Spain. And there were also different models of nation enjoying democracy available to us. One was the British model, the other was the American model. We chose a model of democracy which is wedded to the idea of freedom. See, how did we become a democratic country? We became a democratic country through our freedom struggle. We do not call it our national struggle. We call it freedom struggle. There's a vast difference between these concepts. Similarly, we did not become a unitary country. We became a federal country. If you open the Constitution of India, in the very first part, the very first page of the Constitution, you will find a sentence which says, we the people of India, that is Bharat, which is a union of states. India is a union of states. So India does not precede the union of states. The union of states precedes India. First, primary, most predominant, most essential is the union of states, which means the idea of India presupposes the existence of many states. Similarly, the idea of our democracy presupposes a republic, a federal structure, and a philosophy of freedom. Quite obviously, when you put all this together, we have rested our constitution on the foundation of diversity. And if our diversity goes down, then to that extent, our democracy suffers. Our federal structure gets weakened. Our nation suffers. I will add that those countries in Europe which went for democracy along with the idea of nationalism, particularly Italy and Germany in the 19th century, ended up inviting fascistic rules in the 20th century. I mean, they took 100 years, but that is the logic. That is, if there is excessive nationalism, it will automatically pave way for an autocratic rule. And the Indian constitution just does not have space for any autocratic rule. If such a rule comes, it means it is a rule or a regime removed, far, far removed from the spirit of the constitution.
Sir, like as you mentioned while giving your introduction also, often it's like it's a debated topic, so we can say that about migrants. Okay, we live in a nation where I think I was reading an article on Paris website. So I think that it showed that more than 40 or 45% of Indians at present are migrants within their entire within their own nation. Pisainath sir also argued that the indigenous skills, okay, that have thrived for millions of years ago, the beavers, the toddy tappers and all, these skills are dying, and the skillsmen, the poor people, are migrating to cities, becoming taxi drivers and all, and we are calling this Skill India. So how, I mean, it's literally ironic that the skills that were millions of years old and exclusive to your own country, that skills are like dying, and on the contrary, you are calling it a Skill India. So, sir, can we call migration or what we say organization? Because we say that बड़े महानगरों को और भाषाओं को बहुभाषी होना होगा. Like metropolitan cities need to be multilingualistic. Okay, but we can't see it happening in our own nation at least. So, the urbanization of the country. Can we link the urbanization of the country to the death of the indigenous cultures and languages and all? Or can we say that the migrants in the city serve as a representative of their own culture and they are expanding their culture? Like, what way can we say this?
Well, I will split your question into at least two, if not more. First, let me speak about migration and then about multilingual cities. The last global report on global migration that I have seen was 2018, prepared by the United Nations, you know, experts. And the UN experts in that report had mentioned that more than 36% of human population has now become daily migrant. And there's a definition given that if you have to travel more than 60 or 70 kilometers every day for your work, you are counted as a daily migrant. That is one third of humanity. Out of 900 crores, 300 crores have become migrants today. The sedentary people, the settled people, landlocked, land-bound people, are moving into a new kind of life, which is a fact. And we cannot expect our country to be an exception to that. Traditionally in our country, the tribal people, when I say traditionally, it is over the last 150 years only. Over the last 150 years, because the tribals became increasingly indebted to private money lenders ever since their land was taken away by the British government. They became indebted to private money lenders, and therefore they had to migrate during some part of the year. Now we are very close to Dashera. So this tribal migration begins at Dashera. And it continues till Holi. After Holi, they return back to their villages to do agriculture because they cultivate only, traditionally, they are cultivated only for one season. The other kind of migration is of nomadic communities who are unfortunately branded in our country as criminal communities. And there are nearly 330 such communities in the country today. And they have been perennially migrant, people like Banjara, Sasis, people like Pardis and so on. All those kids that you see at the crossroads of cities sailing balloons, mark my words, they belong to these communities, perennially migrating. Or those sailors of this, the Chota Mota cheese along the pavements, they are perennial migrants in the country. The third migration is of middle classes moving from whatever their places are in hope of jobs, better education, and they naturally land in cities. But there is a caveat here. Even if India has seen a hugely increased migration, there was a tradition in the past where a city and the surrounding villages were seen as a single unit, a single habitat. You know, please notice when the districts were created during the British times, administrative districts, they invariably included a city or a town and a large number of villages. If there is a single town, maybe 200 or 300 or 400 villages belong to a district. That district, the entire district at that time was a unit of production, distribution, and labor processes. Today, that picture has changed because the producers and the users of the produce, the consumers, have moved at a great distance. You see, Aryan, if we talk of integrating our village and city today, we cannot talk of that when we keep using jeans produced somewhere in Texas or t-shirts produced somewhere in Australia. We cannot, because if we do that, if we practice consumption of goods produced over very long distance, then we cannot hope to bring back this close link between village and city in our country. The most we can do, unfortunately, and this is the second best option, the first best option is to rethink our ecological zones where cities and villages like Harappa and the surrounding villages were one. There was a model of that. We will have to think of eco-cultural zones and think of very systematic development of the entire zone, not just the towns or not just the villages in that zone, but both. Because Indian civilization has been a village civilization as well as an urban civilization. We cannot leave one and only think of the other as Indian civilization. It is the organic link that mattered. And if we want that organic link again, we all of us will have to change our ways of life. But if we cannot do that, because it is not easy to do it, we may have to go for the second best option. And the second best option is to develop villages, at least to the tune of small towns. That is, they should have colleges, public libraries, drinking water, full proper drinking water facilities, transportation, and some means of transportation, such as vehicles. Therefore, they will need a petrol station or a gas station. They will need, therefore, electricity and so on. So the facilities that the village, the city is getting should be available in the villages. At the moment, what we are all doing, to whichever party we belong, to whichever state we belong, is to go for the second best alternative that we have. But please remember that the second best alternative is not a sustainable alternative in the long term. After 50 years or 60 years, we might all think that we made a big mistake in going for that kind of urban-like development for villages as well. We obviously cannot turn a city into a village. We should not turn a village into a city. And therefore, ultimately, in the long run, we will have to think of an organic link of production, distribution, and labor practices that covers villages and cities alike. That is as far as the migration problem. it is then that the migration will become less dangerous, less risky. The second question you had was about multilingual cities. That is, Indian cities have been multilingual all along. In Kalidasa's plays, there are 4 or 5 languages. If I go to Delhi or Bombay, I easily hear 100 or 200 languages if I walk a distance of 2, 3, 4, 5 kilometers. All that we need to do is to recognize that the cities have been multilingual. While the cities are multilingual, our policy still imagines a city like Bhopal to be only Hindi speaking, a city like Chennai to be only Tamil speaking, a city like Guwahati as only Assamese speaking. It is like, you know, while a child grows up, parents still keep calling that child Chintu, Pintu, Pinky, Rinky, but the child has grown. So we have to have a very realistic attitude to our cities and recognize their multilingualism as a source of strength rather than as a problem.
Sir, we are now more 75 years independent now. We have, since independence, we are now 75 years older. Okay, so I can't say, because as far as I can see, I can't say that we are like, we have overcame all the effects of colonialism that it had on us. So we sort of have a cultural slavery that you were like just talking about, that wearing the products made in Texas and USA and all. So the local food, the local production change, which we call the local production chain, is anyhow getting destroyed. Okay. So in that context, because I was also reading a statement of yours that I found similar, that I read in a book by Anupam Mishra. Anupam Mishra was an environmentalist. You must be knowing about him. Yeah. So his book is Saaf Maathe Ka Samaj. It's a book of him. So I read him, and I would like to like literally quote it, sir. Just a second. I have that quote stored, and I wanted literally to present it to you to like ask you that what exactly should be done. Yeah, sir. See, he says that मैं ये मानता हूँ कि किसी इलाके की जो समस्याएं हैं वो उसकी भाषा में सामने आती हैं, उसकी भाषा में ही उसके हल निकलते हैं. अंततः भाषा यानी केवल जुबान नहीं है, जुबान केवल एक अंग है, लेकिन जीव का संचालन दिमाग से होता है. तो एक भाषा विशेष का दिमाग भी बनता है, वह दिमाग वहां के पर्यावरण और उसके समाज से बनता है, उसमें उस समाज की सफलता और असफलता भी शामिल होती है, उसमें उसकी ठोकरों से भी दिमाग बनता है. सफलता के फूल व फल के साथ असफलता की भी पत्तियां गिरती हैं, पतझड़ वाली, वो भी समाज को उसकी भाषा को दोबारा खाद बनाकर देती हैं. ठीक है, अपनी गलतियों से भी समाज सीखता है. भाषा और समाज इस तरह से, भाषा और समाज में मैं इस तरह से रिश्ता देखता हूँ. सो एट प्रेजेंट टाइम व्हेन वी से दैट द कॉलोनियलिज्म और द वी कैन से द यूरोपियन पावर्स और द सो कॉल्ड मॉडर्न इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर एंड बिलीफ आर ओवर लाइक हैव ओवरवेल्म्ड इन आवर सोसाइटी, लाइक इट्स अ न्यू ट्रेंड टू हैव स्पाइक्स इन योर हेयर. आई एम नॉट लिटरली अगेंस्ट द हेयर स्टाइल, बट आई वॉन्ट टू लाइक द इन्फ्लुएंस फ्रॉम विच इट कम्स. So in such a time, okay, and we are seeing that our most developed cities are getting, even the Indira Gandhi National Airport was waterlogged at present. So can we say that this all is happening, like at one hand we are becoming modern, so-called modern, and on the other hand even our basic infrastructures are failing, our national capital is drowning within 2 hours of rain. Okay, so can we say that all this is because the treasures of knowledges, the treasures of witness in native languages, in tribal cultures, in native cultures have now literally lost, and that like we are slipping it away. So can we just link to these two things, sir?
We can. The question is, should we? We certainly can. Let us look at this. I fully agree with Anupam Mishra. I agree with every word of what you read out, and more than what you did not read out. But let us look at this question slightly differently. And it is, Did we have those languages before the British arrive here? The answer is yes, we had those languages. Do you think that we had found answers to some of these problems before the arrival of the British? So we'll say no, we did not. Then somebody might go further and say, but because the Mughals were there, the Turks were there, etc. The Arabs were there, all kinds of things. Let's in imagination go beyond that period also. Had we found answers to many of these issues, and we have to return from that question with a degree of disappointment. We did not actually figure out how the human life can be happy for everybody, not just for some. And therefore, if we keep going back like that, trying to see where we happy at any time, was everybody happy in our society at any time? We come up with the observation, unmistakably, we come up with that observation that it is the caste system in our society which is at the root of many of these difficulties. It is the caste system which ruled out minimum human comfort for a large numbers. The caste system controlled education in such a way that women were kept out. And as a result, women who are an important part of the production chain of a society could not bring their knowledge to the field of knowledge. What we call knowledge prior to the British, prior to the Mughals, prior to whoever you want, however long back you want to go in history of the last 3,000 years, that is from the beginning of the Vedas, Rig Veda, till today. Women, we ill-treated women in this country. Well, there are names of Vedic rishis, but where are those Vedic rishinis? There are none. There is an occasional exception, but that exception is found in a mutt, that is in a codified, canonized small group of scholars. There are occasional women scholars, such as some mathematicians, some physicists, somebody who composed Sukta and all that, very few. We kept women out and we kept laboring classes out of anything that we thought was of value. And as a result, metaphorically, we kept nature out of culture. For culture, the Hindi word is Sanskriti. So those who have Sanskrit have Sanskriti. We thought this is culture, and women and the scheduled caste, today we call them scheduled caste or Dalit, but other caste, laboring classes are outside culture. So we had drawn a deep wedge between nature and culture long time back. And in all the succeeding eras, whenever a new force came to India and dominated it, we took only those things from that force which allowed us to keep nature and culture away. The Brahminical Sanskriti and the rest of India separate. We did it during the Mughal times. We did it during the colonial times. Our Brahmins, I'm not talking about a Brahmin caste. But Brahmins' mental mindset, our cultural Brahmins, thought they were like the British lords. They acquired everything that the British, they acquired every good thing that the British had for themselves only. And people like Ambedkar had to struggle against this, battle against this. People like Gandhi had to struggle against this. Gandhi brought women to the social, social presence, and Ambedkar brought the Dalits to social presence. So it is colonialism was bad, and so were the other foreign rules. I do not deny that. I agree. But worse than colonialism and other rules was our internal colonialism. We accepted external colonialism because we were internally colonized. Our people started calling the British government "My Bap Sarkar." So, at the height of the British colonial rule in India, there were not more than 7 lakh soldiers, British soldiers in India, maximum, as against 40 crores, 30 crores Indians. Indians could have easily overwhelmed them physically. They did not do so because we were internally colonized. Colonization has been a long-term mental condition of the Indian way of thinking. And that we need to change by bringing in new forces from all over the world. All over the world. So let us blame ourselves as much as we blame others for where we are. There is a lovely sentence in Shakespeare's, one of Shakespeare's plays. And it is, the sentence says, it is in us that we are underlings and not in our stars. So not in the colonial experience was terrible. I don't justify it. I condemn it. But I cannot say that all that is evil here is because of that. A lot of it we had, it is homemade. Jaise Modi ji bolte na, make in India. So Indians have made this internal colonialism, hatred for women, hatred for Dalits for a very long time, and now they are doing it again. Okay.
So, sir, it was literally a very good answer. Thank you for that. Sir, one more question. It's a statement. So I'll just ask that, to what extent do you agree with it? There is an ongoing debate about a national language. Even some of the textbooks mention Hindi as national language. Even in my school, I saw some textbooks that in Hindi that wrote that Hindi hamari rashtrabhasha, and children memorized it. So, sir, I want to see, I'm a Bhojpuri speaker. My mother tongue is Bhojpuri. There is no script of Bhojpuri. People say that wo bhasha nahi hai, bas boli hai. But it is an ancient, it has its own culture and words. So, sir, I want to ask you that can I say that Angrezi Hindi ke saath jo karti hai, wahi kaam Hindi, Bhojpuri, Awadhi aur anya choti-choti bhashao ke saath karti hai. So, how, sir, up to what extent do you agree with me?
For I would like to tell you 3 things here. The first is, Angrezi is not doing anything to Hindi. Hindi is doing something to itself. And the second thing is, Bhojpuri was claimed in the last census by more than 5 crore and several lakhs, 2011 census, as mother tongue. It is today the world's fastest growing language. You will be surprised to know this. Bhojpuri, there are 2 languages which are the fastest growing languages in the world. One is the Basque language in Spain, and the other is Bhojpuri in India. It has got its music, cinema, theater, oral traditions, literature, the graffiti, newspapers, everything. So Bhojpuri star is rising star. that I would like to assure you, as a speaker of Bhojpuri, I would like to assure you that the star of Bhojpuri is the rising star and not declining star. But your other question about is Hindi or can Hindi be the Rashtrabhasha? Our courts, our constitution and our governments have given a very clear answer that it is at best a Rajya Bhasha and not Rashtrabhasha. So people often confuse between Rajya ki Bhasha and a Rashtra ki Bhasha, Rajya Karne ki Bhasha. And this confusion is of greatest interest to me sociologically. The interest is that Indian people have never thought that the government is all for them. Indian people have believed in feasts, festivals, dances, music of their own, myths, dreams, legends of their own. And the state plays a very minimal role in the life of Indian people. And that's how Indian state should be. So when people think that Rajya Bhasha is Rashtra Bhasha, they're confusing between the two. And in India, which is made of many language groups, every language should be the language of our Rashtra. Tamil should be Rashtra Bhasha, Malayalam should be a Rashtra Bhasha, Hindi should be a Rashtra Bhasha. That is what our Rashtra is all about. We need two or three Rajya Bhashas. That should be enough. And if Hindi serves that purpose, I have no objection. My only objection is the kind of Hindi use in Sarkari correspondence is beyond my comprehension. I just don't understand the words they use. It will require very super brainy Indians to understand what the government writes to people or what the government writes to itself. Nobody knows. Even people in the government don't understand what is written in Hindi as far as that Hindi the government uses. So in any case, people of the country use a loose kind of Hindi, jo Hindi cinema mein milti hai, Hindi geeto mein milti hai. And everybody is happy with that. So there are two Hindis. One is Hindi of the people, jo Rashtra ki hai. Or dusra hai Hindi of the government, which is Rajya ki Hindi. The government has accepted that Hindi as Rajya Bhasha. I wish it good luck. I hope it survives. Rashtra ki jo Hindi hai, which is spoken everywhere, and people don't grumble at all because Indian people are multilingual. So Gujaratis speak that Hindi, but they speak Gujarati as well. Marathi speakers speak that Hindi, but they speak Marathi as well. And there has never been a battle between the two. This bogey of Hindi as the language is now and then created, raised, when employment in UP and MP goes down, when there are frustrated young people who have no jobs, then leader comes along and says, look, your language is the language of the nation, so you have reason to feel proud. Lekin uske jeb mein paisa nahi hai, jaise ek Hindi gana hai, it says chino arab hamara hindosata hamara rehne ko ghar nahi hai sara jahan hamara. So it's false pride which is generated. In India, we'll be happy with its many languages and many speakers of many languages only because India is a union of states and not a nation imposed on those states. Thank you. I think we should stop, or I will take one more question at the most.
Yeah, okay, sir. I'll just have one more question. I'll end it with it. Every period in the past, whether it be any civilization, has had language of intellect, what we call at some point, maybe it was Prakrit in India or Brahmi, or even Persian language has also been a language of intellectuals at some point in history. So in present, at present, whether it be India or the world, so which language according to you can be called that it's the language of intellect of today's time? So what can you say on this?
Fox Pro. Computer languages. They are doing most of our intellectual work because most of our intellectual activities are happening in silence. Teaching is through a medium which is silent. It doesn't allow human kind of interaction. Publications are happening in silence without voice. And increasingly we are moving towards languages which are visual languages more than oral languages. That is the all over the world, that process of in the evolution, the process of evolution that changes in the offing is coming about. But in the past, at least for the times during which we know something about our languages, which is 4,000 years from the times of the Harappan civilization. There we know about something about their script, but not about their speech. Yet there is a presence of several languages in that time. Similarly, when Sanskrit arrived here, there was a Proto-Assamese, a language that is mother's mother of Assamese. Or there was a Proto-Prakrit, there was a Proto-Pali, there was the predecessor of Pali. So there were many languages. Even in the classical Sanskrit period, scholars were talking about Yavanika, Parasika, that means Greek language, Persian language, and so on. When Persian became dominant language in India, some of the best writers in modern Indian languages had started emerging, such as Meera, Kabir, Tulsi, Tukaram, Basveshwar, and so on. So India has always been multilingual in its intellectual discourse. The nature of the intellect that India has nurtured and developed is multilingual intellect. And to make it monolingual, to think of any particular language as language of intellectual discourse is not a good idea for India. My idea of India is India with multiple languages, traditions of multiple languages, their conflict and collaboration between those languages, emergence of new languages out of that conflict and collaboration. And that's how India will go on. India is a case of human civilization which is not founded on the idea of duality, us and them. It is founded on the idea of plurality, us as well as them. That is the premise. That is the, that is how it is predicated, us as well as them, not us or them. And I think that is India. That's how even the name of this country is not one but two names. India, that is Bharat. It has several, at least two anthems, songs, Janaganamana, Vande Mataram. People. It has several religions, several languages, different climates. I think we are a beautiful people because our gods are many, our languages are many, our food culture is many, our textile traditions are many. We are blessed in, as they say in classical English, in manifold ways. हम सब एक नहीं तो इंडिया में अल्टीमेटली इफ वी थिंक ऑफ मोनोकल्चरल इंडिया मोनोलिंगुअल इंडिया we will soon be, because we have ideas of heroes and we love hero worship, we can run into the danger of accepting autocracy as a normal condition of Indian politics. It can be there as aberration once in a while, but it should not be normalized. And therefore, plurality is the best way to protect our democracy. Diversity is the best insurance for Indian democracy. मुझे अंग्रेजी भी बहुत अच्छी लगती है, हिंदी से भी मेरा प्यार है, भोजपुरी मुझे बहुत ही पसंद है, सबसे ज्यादा पसंद है मुझे गुजराती, मराठी, कन्नड़। देखिए मैं तीन भाषा में लिखता हूँ और देर इज नो कॉन्फ्लिक्ट इन माय माइंड। टुडे मॉर्निंग आई डिड वन आर्टिकल इन इंग्लिश, आई एम नाउ वर्किंग ऑन एन आर्टिकल इन मराठी, एंड आई डोंट थिंक आई एम टू पर्सन्स, आई एम वन पर्सन, आई एम दैट पर्सन हु इज हैप्पी writing in Marathi as well as in English. लेकिन अंग्रेजी और हिंदी का झगड़ा मत लगाइए, लव इंग्लिश, लर्न इट, मास्टर इट, लव हिंदी, लर्न इट, मास्टर इट, ओनली थिंग इज डोंट फॉरगेट योर ओन मदर टंग इन द प्रोसेस। ठीक है, ऑल राइट, आप जब ये लिखेंगे, ट्रांसक्राइब करेंगे तो हमें भेजना।
Yes, sir. और I'll definitely send it to you. But towards the end, I just want to read this like two lines by Firaq Gorakhpuri. I have stored it. It says that Sar Zameen-e Hind par Aqwaam-e Aalam ke Firaq kafile baste gaye Hindustan banta gaya. So this was it, sir. I'll just end the recording.